Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Just so you know, this is a serious business conference. We're not some kind of, you know, pantomime show where I say something and you answer back. You just sit back and listen. I think and hope you had a great day yesterday. We had some very interesting presentations and sessions and discussions. I hope you also took advantage of the networking opportunities and built contacts, renewed old contacts, met new people, and had a good business day. And last night, thanks to our sponsors, Jack Cooper, I think we had a great evening as well. Sometimes doing business and networking is just really tough, but we have to do it for the sake of our companies. So I hope you enjoyed it last night. And we were also, us Brits, were also introduced to s'mores, which I'd never heard of before. But I've got to say, they were really tasty and we really enjoyed them. Although I'm not quite sure we Brits really got the hang of it and understood how to use it properly. But I think overall we had a great evening, and I hope we can continue the discussions, the business, the networking, and maybe a little bit of fun as well on our final day today. Don't try and sneak off early, because we start off with, you know, a great session now on technology. We move into kind of the new networks and in North America, and then we have a great panel discussion at the end where we discuss some more high-level strategy and share some more ideas on how the industry should develop. But now we're talking about technology, finished vehicle logistics in the digital age. Anyone else in the room who's the same age as me, around 30, when we first started hearing about internet and technology, the big question was, what are we all going to do with our leisure time? Because our life's going to be so much easier. Well, they sure as heck got that wrong, at least in my life anyway. It just means that we now work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And the other thing that I get from IT is when I'm ringing a logistics or supply chain executive and he's really stressed, really under pressure, and can't talk, can't move, can't breathe, my next question would usually be, oh, are you in the middle of some kind of IT implementation? They said, yeah, how did you guess, Louis? So we know the value of technology. We know the huge impact that digital is going to have on our industry, on the whole world, but on automotive, hugely, and for sure on logistics. So what we're going to hear from the panel today is some ideas, some solutions, some technology, what can be done to help take advantage of finished vehicle logistics, or to help vehicle logistics in the digital age. Again, we've got a panel of a variety of different providers, a vehicle maker as well, to share their ideas. So I'd like to start off the discussion by inviting to the podium Gerald Lee, the VP of Vehicle Planning and Logistics from Subaru. Thank you, Gerald.
Thank you, Louis. Good morning, everyone. I wanted to spend the first couple minutes just talking about Subaru, who we are in the United States. But last night I was on the border of having too much fun, and I did tell a few people that I would that innovation and collaboration and synergy and spillage would not be mentioned in my presentation. So anyway, here we go. Subaru in the U.S. Who we are. Subaru America is an importer, distributor, subsidiary of Fuji Heavy Industries. And we have two independent distributors. The company started in 1968 with 13 independent distributors. It was an other people's money structure. So Subaru of New England covers the six New England states. Subaru Distributors Corp. covers New York and North Jersey. They also have a trucking company that you may have heard of, Diversified. We have three regions for the rest of the country, East, Central, and West. We have 12 zones, so four zones in each region. And the rest of the pyramid is 34 districts for those 12 zones and 496 dealers. So, it's easy to look at the operation on a map. So we have New England and New York, and then the green East region is broken down to those four zones, blue Central and West for red. From a logistics standpoint, we have six ports. The independent distributors get to name their own ports. So we have ports in Boston, Massachusetts, Davisville, Rhode Island. They've been there for a long time. Baltimore, Maryland covers Philadelphia and the DC zone, and Brunswick covers Atlanta and Orlando. Brunswick opened in 2013 as we experienced good growth in the Sun Belt. Vancouver has been in operation for us for 20 years, and Richmond, California opened in 2011 to handle more of the growth, again, in the West and South. So, we've had an interesting ride, especially over the last few years. The 2006 was the first year we exceeded 200,000 sales, 1.2% of the market. We fell below 200,000 in as the credit tightening started in 07, and Lehman got us in 08. We hit 216,000 in 09, and then went into the earthquake tsunami period in 2011, but we actually beat 2010, and then 300,000, 400,000, and 500,000 sales over the last couple of years. So if you were an average dealer in 2011, and say you sold 500 cars, in 2014, if you remained average, you would have sold 960 cars. So we've experienced phenomenal growth. From a fun with numbers standpoint, if you look at the results that came out on Tuesday morning, we had 228,000 sales so far this year in 5 months, and that would have beaten our nice performance back in 2009, 216,000. So we did in 5 months this year what we did in 12 months back then. Also from a fun with numbers standpoint, if you look at our results last year in 14, we grew 90,000 sales. The industry grew 900,000 sales. So we were a 3% player that captured 10% of the industry growth last year. And actually that continues for the first 5 months of this year. We're again up 31,000 units, and the industry's up about 300,000 units. So just a crazy good situation for us. Some of the people asked me, what is Subaru doing? So in the David Letterman spirit, I put together a top 10 list. And these are the things that I think are most influential in our success. So the vehicle size got noticeably bigger back in 2009 model year Forester and 2010 Legacy and Outback. I think we were slightly undersized for the American market prior to them, but we weren't underpriced. So that was a tough combination. From a marketing standpoint, we set a brand strategy and we actually stayed the course, which is pretty rare too. We had significant dealer turnover early in the recession as a result of a couple of bankruptcies and some financial chaos. So we lost about 30% of our dealers in that period. All of the replacement dealers had more sales power than their predecessors. So that was a big help. Dealers have invested heavily in facility upgrades and continue to do so today. So the dealers have faith in the Subaru brand and are putting their money where their mouth is. Someone yesterday mentioned the NADA Dealer Attitude Survey. That's the first time I remember that being referred to at this conference. We are, I think, rated number one for value, franchise value. So that's why the dealers are willing to make big investments in Subaru right now. Number five would be internet marketing. And that actually produces measurable demand, which is kind of a stunning concept in the world of marketing. We have higher sales volume that leads to better income for salespeople, so we have lower turnover and therefore longer tenure. Years ago, I used to think of Subaru as almost a training brand for these franchises, for the dealerships that have multiple franchises. We may have been their number sixth or seventh franchise, so they hire somebody, they do well. We train them up, and then they go to a bigger store where they can make more money. So right now, we seem to be in a situation where we're actually holding on to the salespeople longer than most of the other brands, non-premium brands. Number seven, we have high residual values and low incentives, and that produces a virtuous sales cycle. Number eight, we have much better sales and service training, and that leads to better customer satisfaction. Number nine is one of my favorites. We have outstanding partners in vehicle processing and logistics. And number 10, back to the digital age, we have very good and getting even better IT systems. The scalability of our IT systems has allowed us to have tremendous growth with very few headcount additions in my area. So we have a lot of experience, and now we have much better systems to operate in. So I think in looking at the sales situation, with a nod to Louis as a Londoner, we can probably say it was the best of times. It was the best of times. It was a time of high sales. It was an epoch of low inventory. So from a digital standpoint, some of the functions that we cover are extremely important to be as efficient as possible. So the next year I'll talk about is vehicle purchase orders. We submit them monthly to Fuji for production and CKD packing in the following month. And our purchase order is based on the two independents and the 12 zones. So we have 14 inputs into our purchase order with regional approval. I know the zones use dealer input to skew their purchase orders. So from a standpoint of getting field input, I think we're doing a good job there. And that is all fed through one central system. The zone POs for import vehicles are aggregated by facing port, so we have Fuji shipping the right cars to the right place, which is always helpful. Vehicle allocations is a very hot topic among our dealers. I'm proud to say that I have an equal level of unhappiness among our dealers. So that proves that no one is preferenced in the allocation process. The day supply is very low. We go out with an allocation, and right after the month end close, where all the an avalanche of sales come in, and then we finish that in about 3 days. So all the accessory sales occur in that period, and we just finished the July allocation in early June. So now the dealers have visibility to their pipeline. And with such a low on-ground inventory, today they'll be able to have, say, 20, 23 days of inventory that's due them for the month of June, and then 30 days for the next month's allocation, July. So if they have 18 or 20 days on the ground, you can see that the vehicle pipeline is really where they have to focus and sell from. It's also the focus for dealer trades. If you go back to that sales slide, we had tremendous cash for clunkers effect. It's hard to believe it's almost 6 years since cash for clunkers in July, August of 2009. We were actually cutting production, and we could not allocate all of the production that we had in the first half of 2009. A lot of people in the field look at me and say, that never happened. It absolutely happened. So that's how bad things were coming out of the Lehman shock and the uncertainty in 2009. We've been struggling to keep up with ever-increasing demand since then. That low inventory really puts tremendous pressure on the pipeline information, and number one primarily is ETA. ETA was mentioned yesterday. We have a new project in IT, so Louis and I were talking before. Some of the IT guys, usually they don't want to see requests for a huge amount of information, and suddenly they do. So they've asked for 3 to 5 years of sales of supply chain history. And I got excited. I said, oh, this is big data, right? And they said, no, that's nothing. it's data mining. So I was kind of disappointed in that reaction. But they're going to tell us some information from that data analysis of areas for improvement in our supply chain and our ETA accuracy. We also prioritize future pipeline units, mainly sold orders, which are customer deposits on cars. The retailer trading, as the day supply is so low, has been fierce. We're coming out with a new system for dealer trades next month. And sold orders, this is where the customer does come into the dealership. They can't find the car, the dealer can't trade for the car, and now they actually order the car from future purchase orders for future allocations. And I think we have a very high percent of sold orders for a non-premium brand. Over the past year, we've fluctuated from 5,000 to 9,000 sold orders. So on a sales average of about 40,000, we have a lot of people waiting for cars, which is very unusual. Very European though, right, Louis? Don't they all wait for cars over there? One of the things we have from a system standpoint is vehicle planning system. It does continuous deployment, so as we have our purchase orders in, we can allocate those. We can do a test allocation down to a retailer level. The PO by port helps. So if we're ordering cars in June, those cars will be delivered probably in late August or September. So it's a fairly long supply chain, but that continuing deployment of supply allows for more precise planning in all aspects. And we can get numbers out to our transportation partners from a forecast standpoint. We've focused on demand and the marketing side, and we focus on supply and the supply chain side. So we have a new project that I've asked for about 15 years ago, and it was a tracking number. So when we have a purchase order for 40 or 50,000 cars, we'll actually have a unique identifier now, where it's a common language between the factory in Indiana and the factories in Japan, so we can talk about prioritizing a car, or changing the color or option codes of a car, and that will be a big step forward. It will also help us from an ETA standpoint, where right now we commit to the month of when a sold order. I hope to get to the point where we can commit to a day of sold order. We also have a telematics solution coming in 2016 model year on most products, where we will be able to ping a car and get the longitude latitude of that car's location throughout the supply chain. So IT is very excited about that. And I'm not sure what that will mean for us from a processing yard standpoint, but maybe some potential there also. I think the real improvements that have been made over the past year in the scheduling of our port processing, this is the basis for railcar forecasting and advanced shipping notices to truckers. So the scheduling is done. We try to do it on a smooth flow basis. I want the same people doing the same jobs throughout the month. We don't have a month-end push. We have just as much work on the first week as the last week. And that smooth flow should give us consistent daily processing and shipping throughout the month. We optimize for full rail and truck loading and accessory installation hours. Some of the accessories are heavier installs, and we have only so many skilled people that know that accessory, so we will spread those out. from a scheduling standpoint, we're focused on either retailer or cluster, small group of dealers. And by focusing on that, we have been able to reduce dwell time at the ports and our yard operation out at Indiana. The pre-delivery inspection is also performed at all the ports for quality purposes. So the processors are busy. In Lafayette, they run two shifts on production, and actually three shifts on accessorization. So if SIA built 900 cars yesterday, this morning on ground, they probably have about 300 or 400 cars, maybe 500 cars to process. So it really is a continuous flow. Every car that they build is allocated. 24/7 delivery was mentioned a little bit yesterday by a couple people. We know that there's challenges in the car haul business. Every time I look at a trucker at a port or SIA, they look closer to my age than my kid's age. So we've tried to put a push on 24/7 delivery for the following reasons that you can read. And we're looking for the dealers to just be more cooperative with their trucker. So last month we had a national business conference in Indiana. Some dealers were given plant tours so they can see that we're actually spending money trying to increase production. But there's also in addition to the speeches, there was also an expo area. And each department can pitch ideas to the dealers in the expo. So what we did was pitch 24/7. So we had 59 dealers sign up for after-hours deliveries, and we're still working on more, and we'll be less polite with the balance. But the one tower on the left, every dealer was listed on that tower. So if you took 24/7 delivery, your name was in green with a check mark, and if you didn't, you stood out. So we put a little peer pressure on them, trying to explain that the truckers are really part of their extended team, and with the hours of operation that they face and traffic jams and in metro areas, they really should leave it to the trucker and the dispatcher to decide when cars should be shipped and when they would arrive. The second tower there are just blown up photos of our ports and factories. So just to put a little more reality into the supply chain for the dealers from a logistics and processing flow. I have to thank Lisa for lending us a truck. This is a Cassin's truck that came into the expo area. You may find it hard to believe, but logistics doesn't usually get a lot of traffic in the expo. So we brought a full car hauler, beautiful Cassin's truck, loaded with Legacy and Outback, into the exposition area. And we had a key site here near the coffee and the food. So we got a lot of dealer traffic. And if they signed up for 24/7 delivery, they were entered into a contest where they had the right to purchase the cars that were on that truck. And that may sound a little unbelievable in the auto industry, but they were very excited about getting another 9 cars in their allocation. So that's the truck as it was getting ready to leave. And this is Jack Worstall. Jack's an Outback owner. And Jack told me that he actually delivered some of the first cars coming out of Lafayette plant in 1989. So again, Jack doesn't look like my kids, so we have to be nice to these guys. And as Larry Strug reminds me, we may be in a digital age and we may have great systems, but it's still a people business. And Jack was one of the people I had a pleasure of meeting at the National Business Conference. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jerry. A great opening presentation, hearing a car maker's perspective of the requirements and what you're actually doing to collect the information, share the information, how you use it in your logistics and sales processes. As we said at the beginning of the conference yesterday, everything that we do here, particularly perhaps in vehicle logistics, is to serve the customer. Next up is a company, CDN, Car Delivery Network, and one of the things I like in their kind of company profile is that their aim is to simplify outbound logistics. So to hear their presentation, I'd like to welcome to the podium Greg May, the President and CEO of Car Delivery Network. Thank you.
Thank you, Roy. Good morning. Now for something completely different. I'm going to go mobile here, and I'm going to need a volunteer. But Nora is anyone from the AV team? Do you have the microphone for use on the floor? Could we get that real quick? We're going to start out. We're just going to have a little fun because CDN is kind of a different kind of company, and so this will be a little icebreaker to get everyone sort of on the edge of their seats. I need a volunteer. We're going to play something called technology trivia. That'll be a fun game. So. And you'll have a chance to win something. So, could I get a volunteer? Someone without a black shirt on that says CDN. Anyone? Okay. You don't qualify. Give me someone from the audience. Someone that actually had to pay to be here, right? Anyone? Come on. Can I get one? There we go. Okay. All right, come on up. Christopher? Hello.
Hi.
Can we get the mic? And I'll,
it's
Nivea.
Yes.
Okay, Nivea, who are you with? You're
Volkswagen.
With Volkswagen, mm-hmm. Okay. And what has been, as far as the conference goes, what's been the your favorite part or the thing you feel was the most valuable?
Coming from a sales background, I rather enjoyed the Subaru presentation today.
Yeah, very good. Okay. Have you ever done anything like this before?
No.
Okay, well, neither have I. did you sign the waiver, by the way? Okay. Okay, this is a trivia game that we've made up, and you're going to get three questions, and if you get any of the three right, you're going to win this lovely Car Delivery Network Nike Dry Fit Polo shirt. So, one of your competitors, one of the automakers, has been running a theme of advertisements at TV commercials, kind of focusing on innovative people and how that relates to their car line. And one of those commercials focuses on a person who invented the cell phone, mobile phone. So first question is, do you know who the name of that person who invented the cell phone?
No.
Okay. Well, we'll give you a second try. Do you know, actually his name was Martin Cooper. He invented the cell phone in April 1973. So we'll give you another shot. Do you know the car company who uses that commercial?
I'm sorry, I don't really watch television very often.
Well, that's okay. We understand. So it was Mazda, and if there's anyone here from Mazda, sorry. It's maybe
I had a baby like 7 months ago, yep. So I really haven't watched TV
there
lately.
You go. So, okay, third and final chance. This is your last shot, so take a deep breath. Do you have a cell phone?
Yes.
Okay, there you go.
Okay.
Thank you, Nivea. She's a very good sport, and hopefully that gets the ice broken here. I'm just going to kind of be mobile because I think it doesn't seem quite right to be in a fixed position if I'm talking about connectivity and mobile and all that. So I'm going to be connected and use my little electronic cheat sheet here. And if I can find the right page to begin, we'll get started. There we go. Okay. I need the clicker, I guess. Thank you, Julie. Sorry, bear with me. Come on. There we go. I need an assistant. The convergence of mobile wireless technology and advanced computer processing and access to the internet has enabled users to gain really unprecedented access to information. We now have billions of people connected globally through the internet, and it's opened up a whole new era of information exchange, one that's characterized by the ability to freely exchange information anywhere in the world. At the forefront of this transformational wave is the wireless mobile device, smartphone or the tablet. I'd like to take a quick survey. By a show of hands, how many iPhone users do we have in the audience? Whoa. Okay, that's about 85 to 90%. How many are Android users? About 20. Very interesting. Windows phone. Okay. And BlackBerry? Any BlackBerries? Still got a BlackBerry. Okay. You know, that's very interesting because as of the first quarter of 2015, the statistics show in North America, the breakdown is 78% Android and 18% Apple, with Windows being about 3% and BlackBerry and everything else zero. So this group is the inverse of what is the national trend. I think that's very interesting. So obviously a lot of people that favor iPhones. Digital media and these new communication platforms have transformed our life, as you know. Everything from communication, entertainment, publishing, research, commerce, travel, education, healthcare. There's an app for everything, and you have access to virtually any type of information you want. And it's really changed our behaviors. We don't call, we text. I asked my wife, why don't you just call them? She's texting her kids, you know. You've seen this. We read the morning paper on an app on the tablet. We buy things online, and we track them to our front door using tracking information. And all of this has created a new driving force in the economy, something we call the connected consumer. I think I skipped one. Oh, wrong button. So the connected consumer has given rise to a whole new world of businesses and business models. Companies like in automotive or automotive related, Zipcar, Uber, Lyft, entertainment, companies like Spotify, Netflix, communications, companies like Skype, and there's many, many others. Try it over here. There we go. I was hitting the wrong button. It's not the technology, it's the user, and that's often the case. Taking Uber, for example, they have redefined the status quo. They've created a business model that focuses on the connected consumer. They've achieved competitive advantage and captured market share virtually overnight by not simply refining business processes, but redefining it. And as a side note, this is probably a topic for a future panel discussion, but watch what is happening in automotive with the shared autonomy and ride-sharing services like Uber, and possibly even the future development of alternative types of cars from people like Apple and Google. So what does this all mean for automotive logistics? These technologies are migrating into our world of automotive logistics, effectively changing the status quo. And two key elements have emerged, and these are probably the most important points that I would want you to leave with here today. Connectivity and interoperability. One, the first you're probably a little more familiar with, the latter we'll go into in some depth, but drivers are now connected using powerful computing devices, the smartphones and the tablets. And this makes onboard, expensive onboard equipment that we saw come onto the scene a few years ago now really no longer necessary. Data can be captured in the field using these devices in real time, transmitted through the cloud, exchanged between separate systems through APIs or application program interfaces, and file transfer protocols without any intervening manual processes necessary. This topic of interoperability, I think, is an interesting one. I heard it recently from one of the information systems companies in the healthcare industry. It's what makes the cool stuff work. It's what enables a text to go along with, or a photo to go along with the text, or you know, finding a ride with an app, or even paying a bill using your smartphone or tablet. Generally speaking, it's the ability of separate information systems to pass information back and forth without the information losing its original character. This term you may have heard in the discussion of the Internet of Things or smart networks, and in healthcare it's becoming a popular term in reference to systems that communicate with one another, the ability to share healthcare medical information without having to fill out a form every time you go into a healthcare service provider. Main point here, interoperability of vehicle inventory systems, transport management systems, and data capture devices is now not only possible, we believe at CDN it's likely to become the status quo in the very near future. So what does this look like? We see shippers and carriers having the ability to freely exchange data, interoperability of devices and systems, real-time access to vehicle deliveries, real-time access to metrics, and near-perfect supply chain visibility. With everyone connected to the supply chain information, a more efficient and cost-effective vehicle delivery process is attainable. And what that means to the bottom line is that your total cost of ownership of information systems and technology will go down. Some examples of this technology migration that are already taking place, EPOD with cargo damage information, the ability to exit a yard or port site in paperless fashion, seamless data interchange between carriers and sub haulers, real-time vehicle status updates, and the ability of shippers and carriers to see the same data in real time of where their vehicle is in the delivery chain. The new status quo becomes a fully connected supply chain from shipper to carrier to yard manager to driver to dealer, and perhaps at some point even the consumer. This connected consumer is such a force. We believe it's likely to influence how cars are sold and delivered in the future. These millennials, as they are referred to, are very tech savvy, very used to technology, and the more information they get, the more information they seem to desire. From online shopping to tracking their cars on the web, this car buyer of the future is likely to influence how we utilize information technology to a far greater degree. And we would even go so far as to predict there'll be new business models in reaction to this connected car buyer. So I thank you for your time and attention and look forward to speaking with you during the rest of the conference.
Thank you very much, Greg, and showing us how new the benefits, and the way new technology is already impacting on how we can do things, even at the conferences. I had some comments even from people who are saying that, you know, we're trying to show ourselves how new technology works because they were watching you make your presentation about new technology on our new technology. Talking about our finished vehicle logistics live technology, which is actually hosted and sponsored this year by CTM, who's the next speaker on the conference, with his mission, I think many of us know, is to reduce the empty mile factor. So I'd like to welcome to the podium Bill Pawluk, the Chief Executive of CTM. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Louis. Thank you, everyone, for being here, giving me the chance to speak to you today. For those of you who don't know who I am, Bill Pawluk from Convertible Trailer Manufacturing, and I've spent many years working on what's called the Convertible Trailer Project, and I used to have my own fleet up in Western Canada, and we were able to operate a number of trucks there throughout Canada and the USA. And we decided that we're going to do something about all the empty miles that are made in this industry, which are considerable. I think everybody here knows that. And we were able to reduce our empty miles from close to 40% down to less than 5%. And so this is something I can personally attest to. And I'm here today to tell you and share this with you and provide you some more information. Now, you might wonder what this has to do with connectivity in the digital age and computers and all that kind of stuff, but there is a relationship there, and we'll get to it. So we believe that there's many steps to the process of trying to change the status quo. It was mentioned earlier, status quo. Why do we keep going to the status quo? It's what we know. It's what we gravitate towards. We at CTM, of course, believe, and I know we're not the only ones that believe this, so this isn't just a CTM pitch here, so I want to clarify that. We're not the only ones that believe this, but nobody really knows the way that we can go about trying to change the status quo. What's the process? We're doing cookie-cutter business, as I call it. We're just repeating the same old habits. Considerable waste in road, rail, and ocean. We estimate that loss in the industry worldwide at $75 billion annually. This is a very significant number. 20 billion kilograms of CO2, of course, we understand what that means. And we use this as a bit of an example as to things that you maybe wouldn't do or wouldn't allow to happen. Nobody wants to play on the freeway, of course. And you certainly wouldn't do something like this. And these are extreme examples, of course, guys, but I'm going to ask everybody here, why would we do this? And it seems a little bit benign, hey, a truck running around empty. We're kind of used to seeing it. We're accustomed to it. It's the standard today. And in the auto carrier industry, of course, it is the standard. But if you were in any other transportation sector today, you would not see this. This would mean death to them. They simply couldn't operate, because they've raised the standard, the bar has been raised. This is just a quick example. This is all we do every day. And there are exceptions, of course, but that is not the norm. You go out with a full load, you come back and hurry up as fast as you can to grab the next load. And today, there's capacity issues, of course. So we got to turn around, turn and burn is what we call it. Turn and burn. Again, that's the industry standard. I challenge everybody here today, why do we accept this? Why do we insist on accepting this? Oh, it's because everybody else is doing it. I want to challenge that. So we have a three-step process in CTM. We believe that there's three things that we got to do in this industry to change the status quo. Hardware solution. We need equipment that is more versatile, something that can do more than just haul automobiles. And I know for a fact that this can be done. We've proven it. Convert it. That's the same piece of equipment in all three images there. We've done it thousands of times. More examples. We have equipment sitting outside. If you want to go out there and check it out, you can see for yourself with your own eyes. When the truck's coming back empty, what do we do with a conventional carrier? Of course, if we have autos, we're going to haul autos. But if there's no autos to haul, we're heading back for our next load, of course, hundreds of miles away, likely. We believe that we need to create dry space. There's a value proposition already in front of us here within this room. We have automotive manufacturers that are shipping vehicles outbound. We also have vehicle manufacturers here that hire completely, entirely separate fleets to bring in their inbound products, bring in their alternators and transmissions and body panels, et cetera, et cetera. Is there a possibility that maybe we can combine some of the outbound flows with inbound flows? We have to create dry space that can be utilized, because most of the products coming into the plants are in dry space enclosures. Containers or dry vans or curtain sides or whatever mode that is available. We've created what's called an auto box. This product is going into operation in Europe soon. This is a product that we can put two pallets inside, and that can be hauling automotive parts. We might even be able to bring them in line side and use them right there, forkliftable, dry, intermodal. The next phase of this, we're going to get now down to the software side, the connectivity. And Greg made a great presentation about connectivity. These guys are experts. I'm not an expert in software, so just in case, don't ask me those questions. But having said that, though, I believe the general concept of connecting everybody with this information, this common information, could be useful, and more so than ever before. Why can't we connect automotive outbound equipment, versatile automotive outbound equipment that can haul other products? Why can't we, if we can connect autos to autos, different OEMs to different OEMs, why can't we connect also inbound automotive products or even just general freight? Once again, try to make this equipment more profitable, reduce that empty mileage factor, increase efficiency, reduce our carbon footprint. I mean, the reasons are endless, of course. Control your business better. Today, the game is, well, you guys all know, the status quo. We need to up the bar. We need to up the game. Again, no other transportation sector allows themselves to operate empty over 40% of the time. Control it intelligently. We've signed a deal with a company out of Germany, a software group called Inform. Some of you may know who that company is, and they deal with a number of OEMs around the world, 50 plants approximately or more that they presently do work for. They have a product called Syncrotest, and it is a very advanced system. I've examined it, and it's more or less Chinese to me. But I do have confidence that they know what they're doing, because many auto manufacturers in the world do put their faith and trust in them to know what they're doing. And we're combining what they do with automotive outbound and inbound, and we're creating an interface where we can actually bring those two sources of information together by using our style of hardware. Now, this is a map here, and yeah, maybe you probably can't see all the details in it, but this is just simply a demonstration that the system can actually make sense of all the opportunities that exist out there. Figure out where all the dead legs are, and where all the loaded legs are and find the closest point between them to create the, those efficiencies. The red line, is, of course, is the outbound automotive plant or automotive load, and then the curved line, of course, is the one that would typically be empty. The blue line over there shows there's a container to pick up a few miles away. Got to do a bit of a detour. But you don't have to go back all the way empty. Is it worth it to make that detour to go pick up that container? And I know all of this all makes sense to you guys, but what is the challenge? Why aren't we there yet? This is what I ask everybody. We've done some calculations here, of course, on this particular scenario. What would it mean for us to go do a detour? Even if that container wasn't sitting right there at our destination, what if we had to do that detour? What would the math look like? Once again, more curved lines and red lines, et cetera, but we know that by creating these, using these algorithms to make sense of all this data is the key to improved efficiency. It was mentioned Uber. Uber's changed the game, of course. That's what they're doing. They're taking information. They're using this digital age, this technology that we have today, and making sense of it all. In this example, full loaded miles, 382 miles. If we turn around and go back empty, another 382 miles, today's standard means that that truck's working 100% efficiently. And this is what I'm saying, this is not acceptable. This should not be acceptable. We're gonna do a bit of a detour, 138 miles, and then return 278 miles with a container. We'll do the math on this and see what it looks like. In this particular instance, that truck would have profited $229 that day. In today's economy, of course, they actually could make a profit. By doing that detour, they could have over doubled their profit. And this is simply a case of doing a detour even. I used to load my trucks and at my destination, within 20 minutes, I was loaded with another load. I was able to quadruple my profit because all of your costs are already paid in the outbound side. So there's room to help the OEMs reduce their costs, help them become more competitive and, again, more efficient. There's plenty of room. That's what this example is all about. So automotive outbound combined with perhaps parts inbound, general freight flows, when there's no parts coming in, of course, maybe we just want to haul some general freight, integrate ourselves, bring us ourselves closer to the general freight industry. I did it. You put these three together, and I think we can see a significant improvement in today's automotive logistics. Outbound and inbound and anybound, we don't care. And the truck doesn't care. I know this as fact. We want to turn that turn and burn adage around to turn and earn. Why not? We have a lot of bright people in this room. I know it can be done. We invite everybody to work with us. Everybody's situation is unique and special, and it may be more applicable to certain people and certain companies and certain situations more than others. But we invite everybody, and we'll see how we can assist you. No distinction between waste and energy in the future, we say. But the future is here, it's today. Why don't we challenge that? In this case, waste can be converted into profitability, productivity, efficiency. I'd like to make a special thank you to Jack Cooper. They're the ones that supplied the trucks out there, the equipment, the trailers are ours, of course, but together we've been collaborating for the last several years to get this concept across the line, get it integrated into the industry. I'm committed to this, I believe in it, I know it can be done. We do have a legislative problem still today in the US. where we can transport automobiles on our convertible trailer just like any other auto carrier. When we convert it down to a flat deck system, the trailer is legal to carry general freight, but the tractor is not. And it's outdated legislation. And we simply haven't been able to get Congress to get together and approve this new wording in the legislation that we've proposed. Just hasn't happened yet. So Jack Cooper has been helping us get this initiative across the line. That's only one model. We do have a second model, of course, that we can use today, is fully legal. And that's what we're going to focus on for North America. In other parts of the world, we're getting great traction in areas where there's no legislative barriers. Or this legislation here in North America, I call it accidental legislation. It's outdated. It's just nobody anticipated it back in 1982 or whenever it was written. So, but other countries are seeing the merit in this, and we are moving forward. So, and I expect that the U.S., Canada will, of course, join. But we got to get that legislation changed. But anyhow, once again, thanks to Jack Cooper. Short video to end my presentation.
Every year, the auto transportation industry wastes $75 billion, that's billion with a B, on inefficient transport of automobiles. And every year, 20 billion kilograms of needless CO2 is wasted by this inefficiency. Hauling a full load one way and nothing on its way back home. This is known as turn and burn. Think of how many times you've seen a carrier just like this one, empty. We're willing to bet it's over 40% of the time, and that's being conservative. CTM has a solution that is revolutionizing the industry worldwide. Introducing the first auto logistics revolution, the convertible trailer by CTM. We call it the revolution. Auto transport companies can now haul a load of vehicles to the dealer, then, within minutes, convert to a flat deck trailer capable of hauling a fully fledged 40-foot container or freight of any type that a standard flat deck can. Even better, it can haul mixed loads, vehicles, and freight. Nothing else can do this, and nothing else will. It's patented worldwide. Our Revolution trailer may look like a standard trailer, but it's completely different. Simple hydraulic controls assist the operator in offloading his haul in minutes. The vehicles are cleared, and a few more hydraulic transformations converts a historically one-job trailer into a multi-freight hauling system. With a basic loader, the trailer is now ready to fill your empty backhaul miles with real cold hard profits. Adios, turn and burn. Hello, turn and earn. Don't get left behind. Be a part of this global revolution. Convertible trailers can be designed and customized to meet any regional regulations and requirements worldwide. Visit convertibletrailers.com for detailed information on this game-changing innovation. CTM, transforming auto logistics.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bill. I was reading an article about Elon Musk, and they were saying that the reason for his success is hard work, passion, really obsession. And I think that if that's what it takes to be successful, you've got all of those your obsession with trying to reform or transform the finished vehicle logistics industry, Bill, I'm sure will lead to success. Next up, we're going to hear, you know, perhaps from two, but initially, you know, what we may have thought of as a kind of logistics company, a trucking company that's now doing a bit of technology. And maybe soon it'll be the other way around. There'll be maybe United Road will be a technology company that happens to do a bit of trucking and transportation as well. So I'd like to welcome to the podium Matt Cartwright, the Chief Information Officer from United Road.
I don't know if I'm on. Can you hear me? Nice. Excellent. So I'm Matt, and I like computers. I'm a little bit like Greg. I'm not a huge stand behind the podium because I start to get moving around, and the next thing you know, it's like a big whirling dervish, and we got a little bit of a time crunch, and Marco's already promised that he'll tackle me if I take more than my allotted time. So I'm going to try to move through pretty quick, but I work with United Road, and I don't know which button I'm pushing here. Which one am I pushing, the green one? Yeah, cool. So a little bit of factoids for United Road. We deliver approximately 3 million vehicles a year. We have about 10,000 customers that we do that for, 1,700 car haulers, 1,800 employees. We participate in all segments of finished vehicle logistics, so POVs, OEM distribution, specialty vehicles, all those. So we have kind of a diverse set of requirements there. We operate out of 80 locations in Canada, Puerto Rico, and the U.S., and we, I got to participate in all segments again, so I guess we didn't get updated. We do invest heavily in technology, and you know, like Bill, we protect that technology, and so we have a patent for transport optimization. So what I kind of wanted to talk about today was not necessarily a bunch of United Road stuff, but more kind of technology. As Louis indicated, we've put a lot of focus on technology, and how we decide what technology we want to employ is really governed by the same dynamics as anybody else that's in technology. So everybody from this side, come over here so you can see what I'm pointing at. No, just kidding. So if we look at how, and a lot of smarter people than me study this stuff, so if you look at how technology is used, you have kind of emerging pacing key base, and then you have that that turbulence in the industry, and over time, the idea is to improve performance, right? Pretty basic concept, but that's what happens. And then what do you have as far as disruptors, and we've talked about some of those. The interwebs were a pretty significant disruptor, right? Google search, they're a pretty significant disruptor. All the fact that we have smartphones, right, out of the folks here, that's a pretty significant disruptor. And so all those things yield changes in all the industry, and we're not immune from that. So three kind of strategic postures or strategies, if you will. And again, not exclusive to each other. Nobody fits in one bucket or the other, but these are kind of the three ideas. The innovators, so there are certain companies, certainly think tanks, that go out there and just innovate in technology. They look at dynamics and they go build technology for that. The adapters maybe take that technology and then they're going to adapt it to their industry. It requires some modification for there. And then finally, the participants. Those are the people that are going to take the technology and deploy it in the industry. You know, we do that. We've got our smartphones in the industry, and so we'll continue to do that. I would suggest that all of us kind of take different roles at different times. Certainly, we'll focus on different things at different times, but we'll go across those at various times. In United Road's case, we try to be innovative in the technology, but we're also aware that there's a lot of stuff out there that we're never going to invent, so we're going to leverage what's out there and make sure that we take advantage of those things. So what are the considerations when we think about those strategies? Because not only do you think about what sort of components of technology, but what are the drivers for that? As I indicated, with 10,000 customers, we're pushed into a position where we have a pretty significant and diverse set of requirements. Everybody has a little bit different slant on what they need. At the end of the day, it's taking a vehicle, putting it on some conveyance, and then getting that conveyance where it's supposed to go and unloading the vehicle. That's in the most simple form. But we all know it's a little bit more difficult than that. Sorry, I feel like I'm on this side more. I'll come over here for you guys. But as you guys know, there's a lot of influence there. It's not just the customers. It's the people in your business. It's the technology that's available to you that comes from the innovators and those kinds of things. And then you have problem of what type of technology you want to do. So we were talking about implementations, and we were talking about how sometimes you call people and they've been in this implementation for 6 years, and then all of a sudden, 3 years after they finally get it implemented, it's out of date and no longer extensible, and guess what? We're scrapping the whole thing and starting over. So we're in this perpetual implementation. Not the best way to do things, and kind of introduces some inefficiencies where we're trying to be efficient in our technology deploy. So you have to be thoughtful about what you do there, and so we try to do that to make sure that the platforms are extensible. and can take advantage of things that we don't necessarily see today, but also the things that exist. Am I going fast enough? You're not tackling me yet. Good. So when I think about adapting and participating, in particular with our industry, we've got some things that are out there. As Greg shared, we've got EPOD. That's not something that we all invented. Back when I was with UPS, I remember when we rolled out the electronic signature, and you're delivering, I don't know, 20 million packages a day and so on and so forth. And you have to think, when I was first there, they had big notepads and signatures, and then they would take this piece of paper and they would stick it in a file cabinet, right? And then this file cabinet would grow and grow and grow and grow and grow. And all of a sudden, somebody would say, hey, can you get me the signature for this package? Really? I have no clue how to get it, right? So you had a business problem that you had to prove that somebody signed for it, but then you had the retrieval part, which was problematic. So they, of course, 20 years ago started doing electronic signature. We're still doing that as a participant, a little bit of an adapter, but we're still doing that as a participant. I don't think we've taken all the efficiencies that are available to us as an industry that comes from doing some of that electronic information. We still have some paper-based components that are definitely necessary from time to time. But at the same time, I think there's some opportunity to take some of the waste out of there. We still do a lot of paper in the yards. I can't tell you how many times somebody goes in, they walk in, and instead of just doing the work that's necessary to provide throughput, which is getting the vehicle on the conveyance going to point A and unloading, I'm spending time going and getting a document from over here, and then I go get a document from over here, and I go get a document from over here, and then we go and hand these documents out, and then we go and input these things into our respective system, and we spend an hour, everybody's remanufactured the same thing four times, and then on top of that, we go and transmit that data to each other to underneath the scenes, right? So we've already got a lot of the hooks in place. It's just making sure that we take advantage of those opportunities that are there. So this doesn't require a huge amount of innovation. The technology exists. It's known technology. It's used in our industry. It's used outside of the industry. So I think we'll just be challenged to do that. And kind of on the line of collaboration, it takes all of us to do that. If one person decides they don't want to participate in that evolution, it can stop everybody else from progressing. The next thing, and part of what we're doing is innovation, and we talked about investing back in the industry. United Road has always had kind of an idea that technology is important, and so in addition to just buying trucks, which we buy a few of those, we spend money in technology, right? And the latest kind of incarnation of our technology spend is the idea of global optimality in the network. And we've kind of talked about it. I know a lot of people are kind of working on this problem, and I think that's a great thing because it's a complicated problem. In the top left, we've got, lots of trucks, lots of trains, lots of ships, and then lots of inventory, right? And so it's a pretty complicated business process, even though we're saying that it's only a car on a truck and a truck goes somewhere else. So just to give you an idea, we solved this in a linear manner, maybe in 2009, and we figured out with all the combinatorial components of how you deliver, right, whether or not the dealership's going to accept STI, whether or not the vehicle's going to be backed on, driven on, what position it's going to be so I can unload it, load it, all that kind of fun stuff. With an inventory of 500 units and maybe 10 loads that you're building, I think the number when we solved it to guarantee global optimality, in other words, it's the 10 best possible loads that would minimize all expense, there's 245 quadrillion combinations. So then you think about it, well, what if we have 150,000 units that are shippable at any given time and more than 10 trucks? Well, it gets harder and harder and harder. So we're working, in addition to our own algorithms, which we patented in 2007, with a couple other really smart folks that are helping us solve this problem. Because at the end of the day, this is what really happens, is the one on the right. Right? So we take all the freight that exists, all the considerations, right? Because freight's dynamic. We get new freight released to us on a regular basis. Some freight gets pulled back on that basis. Mrs. Smith calls me and says, I need my car shipped to Florida tomorrow. Mrs. Smith calls back and says, never mind, cancel that, about 10 minutes before you pull up. All those things happen, so you have to be able to react, right? But if we can get down to this level, which is what the technology will do, and plan out on a five-day horizon, we think that some of that capacity that's out there, you know, we call it kind of idle capacity, can be used without just continuing to reinvest in the asset. So wrapping up, the thing that I think about, and I think we should all think about, are the what Google calls the moonshots, right? So all of a sudden you have some new idea and you want to flesh out that idea. I think there's a lot of opportunity for us to do that. So often it comes out of the industry and somebody just says, hey, I saw this happen over here, right? And it has nothing to do with anything with work. You know, your family comes up and says, this was the coolest pizza cooker in the world. I don't know if it has an application, but we need to be aware and open to those ideas, you know, and then that's where I think some of the collaboration is thinking about that. So what are the next disruptive technologies that are coming? I don't know what they are, but we'll see them, right? Nobody saw search as the thing that would launch Google, right? There's nobody really thought, you know, YouTube was a great thing, and now all of a sudden you can't imagine living without it. Will we be positioned to take advantage of those things? You know, and what's our responsibility as innovators and adapters and participants? I think we can do a better job as adaptors and participants. You know, innovation's obviously expensive, and there's lots of people that do that kind of stuff, so there's some risk there. But I think we've got to work to do that. And then how do we progress the total industry? You know, the collaboration theme is really important because if any of the chain, right, supply chain, I don't want to use like buzzwords, but if anything's wrong along there on that continuum, it becomes a problem that leads to remanufacture leads to cost, right? And then we've just taken that out of capacity and turned it into unavailable capacity, and therefore we can't use it, right? So those are the things that I think about, and I'm really interested in what you guys see. I see what I see, and it's, you know, a pretty wide swath of things, but I'm not naive to think that there's not a bunch of stuff back here, over there, that would be helpful for us. I'm also not naive to the fact that there's competitive things, so collaboration sounds super. So we have to make sure, though, that we're aware of competition because there's things there. But we're certainly open to collaboration, and I think this meeting in particular is nice to go put names with faces and then to go and say, hey, this is my problem. This is our opportunity now, right? And I think that we can solve those. We just have to be willing to invest the time because collaboration sounds like a good term, but unless we make it an actionable item, right, and we go spend some time and we change a little bit of what we do, you know, without change, it's kind of the same thing over and over, and here we're going to be talking about computers again. But I like them, so I can talk for a lot of time. So I'm overrun by 18 seconds, and I'm going to switch it to Marco.
Thank you very much, Matt. And it's interesting to hear that the presentations we're getting from the vehicle logistics companies, surprisingly enough, aren't saying, hey, we've got the fastest drivers or the fastest trucks. It's all about the technology. So also, you know, to discuss this about how logistics is all about the technology nowadays, a company that's new to Finnish Vehicle Logistics Conferences, I'd like to welcome to the podium Marco Maggiore, the VP of Sales and Marketing for Montway Auto Transport. Thank you, Marco.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you again, Louis, for the introduction. Pleasure to be here. As Louis had mentioned, this is our first time attending the conference. So really what I wanted to do today is try and not turn this so much into a commercial about us. promise I won't try to sell you something for $19.95 or throw in a second one just for the extra cost of shipping and handling, but I did want to take the advantage right now to kind of give a little bit of background about who we are and what we do, because the most prominent question I've been asked during our time at the conference is, what do you guys do? So we are new to the FVL space, but by no means are we new to the industry. In fact, in what has been a very short amount of time, we have grown to become one of the largest auto management companies in the United States. And it's important for that distinction is that we consider ourselves an auto transport management company as opposed to a traditional carrier, or even for that means a traditional broker. We, during our time working in the industry and building up our network, we have actually grown to the fact to where we have one of the largest networks in the United States. We work with over 8,000 plus carriers who represent 20,000 plus trucks on the ground. I guess my question then is, who exactly are we then? So we were founded back in 2006, and really we were founded with a mission to bring technology and user experience to the auto transport space. We really look at ourselves, and the term around our office a lot is that we're an auto transport provider by trade, but in actuality, we are a technology company at heart. We actually house a team of developers in office, which is unique for a company in our space. And I'm not talking about a couple guys that we throw in the corner with some Macs and say, go create something cool. We literally have a team of 20 plus developers that are constantly working not only on the technology we use to run Montway for our backbone, but also the technology that's used by our partners. Everything we build is from the ground up. We're not an out-of-the-box type of company. Every partner that we work with has their own unique set of challenges and needs. And as a result, every time we build a piece of technology, it's for exactly what the need is for that particular partner. We cut our teeth really in the POV space for retail consumers. We worked, again, an emphasis on the service level behind it as well. Proud to state that we are an A-plus accredited company with the Better Business Bureau. And we're a 5-star rated company across the board on review sites, to where a lot of our customers have the chance to go and actually talk about their experience with Montway and our carrier network. We entered the kind of technology realm when we started partnering with a lot of consumer websites, the cars.com of the world, Auto Traders of the world, Auto Trader Classics, to where we actually created a technology piece for them that integrated in their user experience. Kind of a synergistic value that if you're a customer looking to shop for a car on one of these sites and you found one that is out of state, a natural progression is how much will it cost and what resources are there to bring it from me at origin to me at destination. So we've integrated with a lot of technology pieces to help them in their process to kind of position them as the thought leader in the space. As I mentioned, we do have a large network of carriers. Another thing that was important to us as well, though, is that we looked at this as if we wanted to go ahead and really expand. So once we kind of got our presence known in the consumer space, we looked what might be some other options for us out there. And we decided we wanted to go into the B2B space, and one of these industries that we targeted was the moving and relocation space. The understanding that in order to operate in this space is that there was a need for technology to help bridge the gap between the providers and the actual end customers. With that being said, is we created what we term our Miles Ahead portal. This is a portal specifically built with the moving and relocation companies in mind that gave them the ability to instantly get quotes. Spot quote model, so that we were quoting them the best available price at the industry at that second in time, as opposed to a lot of the basic rate sheets that they had been using. We also gave them the ability to book online, track their orders, have reporting, and all this is cloud-based. So as long as they had internet connectivity on your cell phone, whether it's Apple or whether it's Android, on their tablets, on their laptops, you can imagine the application of these sales agents actually in the field sitting down with their customers and booking auto transport moves using our portal. In 18 months worth of work in this field, we went from someone who is introduced to it to the major player. We by far have the most market share in that particular sector. This is from folks who not only work with us and our services, but integrate our technology deeply to where they're white labeling the technology. These are large companies like the Service of the World, Cartus, Unigroup, Grable, Move Management, et cetera. And really, that's when we coined and started developing what we talked about as our auto transport management company model. Why this was needed is that, look, technology is fantastic, but the bottom line is it's still that experience with people. It's that interaction with the truckers and interaction with the people who are dispatching the truckers. So we went ahead and created what we call our VIP team. This is a team that is dedicated 100% to bridging the gap between the auto transport providers and the end customer, meaning we're the conduit between there. Questions come in, concerns come in. We're going to be that acting kind of feet on the street to make sure there's a good experience across the board. With this kind of group in place, we were able to establish quality scores, and quality scores are going to be based upon the ability to actually pick up on time, deliver on time, minimize damage whenever possible, having good experiences for the end customer. Our KPI scores came in at a very high 98.8% rate, which means that our team was doing our job and performing the services that were needed. The other thing that was important is that we knew that with our network of carriers being so large, it was very important to come up with a method to vet these carriers. We needed a way to establish higher quality carriers from those who were developing. At a high level, we integrated with SaferWatch, which ties directly into the US DOT. What this allows us to do is, on a high level, make sure people are compliant, paperwork is in order, et cetera. But then we knew we had to drill down as well. So we actually created a team within Montway, and we call it our carrier relations team. And this team actually put together an algorithm type of scoring system that rated carrier performance so that we could, within our system, within our network, which is very large, delegate top ranking performers in order to go ahead and distinguish them and give them those opportunities that would be best suited. So the more impactful loads, the more VIP loads, loads that we were moving for Apple and some of the leading companies in the United States, we would minimize our network to those carriers who are best suited and best equipped to have success with that. With that being said, kind of as background, this is kind of the time where everyone should perk up a little bit, because now I'm going to explain what I feel is our value proposition to your industry in specific. What we are looking to do is to come into your industry now and make a difference, to try and ease some of those pain points that I've been hearing, not only from manufacturers, but from the carriers as well. I'm somewhat of a quote guy. I do like quotes. I have them in my office all over the place. I drive people in my office crazy because normally I answer a question with a quote. And one I want to pull from right now is from an ex-president, good old Abraham Lincoln. He was quoted as saying, "Give me 6 hours to chop down a tree, and I'll spend the first 4 sharpening the axe." That really is a good message as to what our approach is to entering this industry. We want to observe and discover what the pain points are, really try and come in with solutions and tools, kind of sharpen our axe so when we come in, we can make a difference. And again, this is collaboration not only from the manufacturers, but from the carriers as well. We want to have the conversations with the Jack Coopers. We want to have the conversations with the United Roads, with the Cassins. We want your feedback because we want to know how we can help on your aspect and your side as well. Of course, technology-wise, we're looking to adapt our very successful Miles Ahead portal in order to service the needs of the manufacturers and dealers. We've been fortunate enough that we've been able to actually pilot with a couple OEMs over the last year or so that have used our technology and our service level. And I'm happy to report that we've been able to maintain that high KPI performance rate that I had mentioned earlier with the moving and relocation space. Primarily, we started working with spot moves. We were able to prove our model and validity for those type of movements. And now we're starting to actually get into the more attractive contract work, which is obviously the route in which we want to go. Our technology, I wanted to talk about a little bit, is that it is a standalone piece of technology so that it can be used by itself to help OEMs and manufacturers work within how they dispatch loads to auto transport companies, how they get quotes out, etc. For us, it's a streamlined process. We know that a lot of you are actually working with other technology pieces right now. We're able to be a snap-on on that as well, so you don't have to kind of tear down the systems you already have in place. We're able to integrate with what is existing right now in order to find a benefit from what we bring along with the systems that you're currently using as well. As far as our design and our ethos, you could kind of take a look. Again, another quote for you. It's for gentleman Milton Glaser. I'm not sure if anyone knows who Milton is, but if you're from New York, you might. He's the gentleman who actually created the I Heart New York logo. Very simple logo, very powerful, he had a lot of success with it. You can see from some of the design work that we have that we're very simplistic with our design. We feel that that's the best way to communicate information to the people who use our network. And we do drill down as far as how we show information, et cetera. One of the points I wanted to talk about now is a theme we've heard a lot throughout these conferences have been capacity and the stress on capacity. We might have a little bit of a different take, and some people might call us naive or maybe not looking at it the right way, but we have data that we think supports our opinion, which is capacity in the industry, it's judged primarily based upon the assets of the larger carriers. And really, there seems to be not a lot of consideration or little, if any, to maybe smaller carriers that aren't as well positioned or as well known. But when you look at those carriers as a cumulative group underneath the Montway umbrella, underneath our network, there's trucks there. There's trucks there that are ready and willing to move. Again, they might not be companies that are prominent you've heard of before, but because they're part of our system and our customer service and our technology is tied into it, the success rate is there. So we feel that we could come in and offer an alternative solution for capacity that maybe hasn't been tapped into because it hasn't been considered as viable. Another point that has been brought up a lot has been backhaul issues. We've heard terms throughout yesterday like the Da Vinci tool discussed. We have been operating the same type of technology very successfully for the last 2 years. True, we don't have as cool a name as Da Vinci tool. I think we might have to rename ours. But we've been using this within the moving and relocation space. And again, this has been proven. This has worked. We kind of refer to this as our round trip assistance. What we do is we take all of our volume that gets funneled in from Montway, whether it's those POV moves, those retail opportunities, spot moves, our moving and relocation moves, which has a ton of volume to it, our direct moves with large corporations. Again, I mentioned Apple, Apples of the world, the Microsofts of the world, the Amazons of the world. And we take all of this and we funnel it into an easy system to where you're able to build backloads based upon the lanes in which you're transporting to. Again, the availability is shown in a very simple interface. And again, what is shown is going to be vetted based upon those carrier scores that we talked about. So that if you're more of a high profile carrier who has a high ranking or high score with us, there's going to be more opportunities for you to choose from because of the fact we've had success with you, as opposed to maybe you being a developing carrier and we have to be careful and vet who we award these high profile moves to. Regardless, though, is there is going to be that ability that you can build backloads based upon the influx of volume that we have within our system. I personally feel that we're very lucky to be in our industry right now. It's an absolutely fascinating time, and there's a huge opportunity to pioneer solutions right now that will lead the next generations going forward. Our friends at Gartner actually kind of refers to this whole convergence of technology and actually use as the nexus of forces. It sounds eerie, right? Kind of some strange movie title. But basically what they've said is it's the convergence of mobile, social, cloud, and information patterns that have become the platform for digital business. Digital business is the creation of new business designs by blurring the digital and physical worlds. And that's really what I feel it's all about. We certainly live in the digital age of business. Here are a little stats, a little factoids for you. Within the next 5 years, nearly 3 out of every 4 businesses will be digital or preparing to become digital. However, many of these companies' digital transformation efforts will fall short because they're not looking to reinvent or reimagine their business from the top to bottom. In a large part, this is due to not having the proper information and expertise advising key decisions. This comes directly from Gartner's top 10 strategic predictions for 2015 and beyond, recently published in February. By year end of 2016, 50% of these digital transformation initiatives will be unmanageable due to the lack of management skill, leading to a measurable loss in market share. Frankly put, becoming a digital business requires rethinking core business processes and implementing a foundation and intelligence system that combines security, mobility, cloud, social, and analytic technologies. For us here at Montway, we feel that we are uniquely positioned to help out the dealers and OEMs in the space in this transition from traditional to fully digital with our solutions that have been proven. Again, our Miles Ahead portal really needs to be looked at as a duality here. It not only serves the manufacturers and OEMs, but it serves the carriers as well. It's a means to better communicate amongst ourselves, a means to do business smarter, more efficiently, more cost efficiently. And we're looking for, again, your feedback and how we might be successful in adapting what we've done in that moving relocation space to your specific space as well. Again, we're talking about things like the ability to instantly get quotes, to book, track, report, a user experience that is easy and intuitive, and of course our award-winning VIP service that comes along with the operations of moving freight from point A to point B. So basically, in conclusion, our take is that digital business technologies are disrupting business operations in ways that have not really previously been seen. Thought leaders should act as change agents by adapting their thinking, their methods, their technologies to support fluidic change and by becoming proponents of digital technology. I'm going to close again with another quote, just because I had to do at least three. There was like seven in there and I had to weed out like four of them. But this is by another former president, Mr. Bill Clinton. The price of doing the same old thing is far higher than the price of change. And we really feel that we can come in, make an immediate impact on change in your industry. Again, dualistic approach, not only the manufacturers, but the carriers as well. I would be remiss if I didn't add one small last thing to my new friend Greg over at the Port of Tampa. Go Hawks. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Mark Cohen. Again, an indication there about the importance of technology to vehicle logistics. I said at the beginning that technology and IT were supposed to help us, and the question was going to be, what are we going to do with our leisure time? Because everything's going to become more efficient and faster and leaner with the use of IT. So it's indicative that our IT session has therefore overrun. But I will take maybe one question from the audience, just to, if there's anyone who's got a particular question or anything they want to raise, agree, disagree, please, now's your opportunity. As usual, raise your hand, wait for the microphone, and ask the question. So, okay, then don't think you're getting away easily because of that. Just one question, and unfortunately, being the IT expert that I am, I'm not even sure how to phrase the question. But it's about, you know, the kind of collaboration, integration, interoperability, because one of the challenges with all of those things is, you know, the two words go together, even though they're complete opposites. It's collaboration and then competition. So how all this data, all this information that's collected, perhaps only works if it's shared and if everybody can have access to it. Are all of your systems standalone systems where everybody has to use your system, and then if Jack Cooper says you have to use ours, and you know United Road says you have to use ours, and the car makers say you've got to use ours, are there too many systems that don't interact? So to the technology, or to the logistics service providers, perhaps, how interoperable is your system? Can you really share, connect? Can other people really use the system?
I'll take it. Mm-hmm. It's mic time, so it's good for me. I think it's a critical thing that we look at as far as how extensible is the platform, and I think it's one of the worries that I think about is if everybody goes and builds a different system, we're introducing new inefficiencies that weren't there before. So for us in particular, we work very hard to make sure that it's an open API. I would not be fully truthful if I didn't say I'd prefer you use our technology, but that shouldn't be a gate to us progressing the efficiencies of having these systems. So we definitely make everything open so that other folks can use those. I know we've looked at other people who have mobile apps and just integrating direct to them. So if they've got something out there as opposed to saying, you know, you got to download and use ours. So I think there's opportunity for us to maintain the competitive edge that we all need to maintain, but at the same time work towards a little bit more collaborative effort so that our pride in authorship doesn't stand in the way of gaining efficiencies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would agree with that completely as well. I mentioned that our approach is one that we are completely customized with everything we build. One of the reasons we made that decision was exactly to Louis' point, which is we know there's other systems that pre-exist out there. For us, we look at our technology and what we bring almost as a snap-on type of component so that we can build it to play friendly with your systems that might already be in existence. Listen, certainly ours can operate as standalone, but the majority of the partners that we've integrated with technology-wise have had relationships, contractual, what have you. They've put a lot of investment within technology internally, and we build our systems out so that it's not predatory to that. It just adds an extra layer of some functionality that might have been missed and might have not been applicable to maybe an out-of-the-box type of product that gets purchased a lot. So for us, it's making sure that we stay open with our APIs, et cetera, and just know that, hey, we're able to play friendly with other systems.
And just to add to that what Marco and Matt said, I think the new normal for information technology is going to be the ability to share and exchange data between service providers. The days of silos and legacy systems that cannot integrate and share data with other service providers are probably going away. They're not gone, but I think the bar has been set where if you're going to have IT, you're going to have the ability to work with open APIs to send and receive with others.
With CTM, we one of the key mandates that we had was, the very first mandate was that this system that we develop must integrate and operate with any other system out there. And I know the perception out there says, hey, competition, hey, they're gonna control our data and have access to our data, and right away they're going to know something about our business, et cetera, et cetera. There's many components to the entire process, I think, and everybody jumps into that process at some level. And so our philosophy is that jump in at any level that you want. We're going to try to aggregate as much data as possible to identify inbound and outbound flows, the synergies that lie within, and then, of course, bring in general freight as well. Ours being a very unique approach, of course, from the convertible perspective, but plug and play with everybody in the room and in the industry, that's our key mandate.
Okay, thank you. All right, one question now, but it's gonna have to be the only question and we will need quick answers for this.
Hello, this is Rick Wishon from Toyota. Quick question. So with the interoperability, one of the things I think where we could benefit as an industry for this is with electronic proof of delivery and the portals that all the carriers are putting together, we have, in one example, dealers that have to have access to four different portals to pull down their delivery receipts. It would be really nice if we could collaborate together and put together one master portal for registration of dealer emails as well as pulling delivery receipts and that kind of a thing, and share that rather than have the dealers keep track of four different IDs. So food for thought.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Good idea.
Okay, thank you. One of the, probably the original question we used to get about IT at our events was, why can't we be more like Amazon? You know, you can track a book, you can, you know, the smallest thing, you know exactly where it is, and we can't track and trace a car. But I heard the best answer to that question from a car maker who said, why can't we be more like Amazon? Because we need to make money. So that was an interesting point. So I'd like to thank the panel for their contribution. We'll be reconvening at 11:10. Is that right? Is that how it'll work? Yeah, 11:10, to give you the chance to grab a coffee and network and et cetera. Thank you.